So right here, I have two potential solvents that you might see some type of reaction take place in. The one on the right is a very typical one, probably the most common of all solvents. This is water. And this right over here is diethyl ether. And we'll talk about naming things like this in the future dates, but you can see what's going on right over here. You have two ethyl groups attached to this oxygen in between, diethyl ether. But the important point here is to realize where are these two solvents similar? Where are these two molecules similar and where are they different? The places that they are similar is in both cases, oxygen, which is one of the most electronegative of all of the atoms, that in both cases it's bonded to things that are less electronegative. And so that allows oxygen to hog the electrons more often. It has a higher electron affinity. And so you'll have a partial negative charge for both of these molecules on the oxygen side. And you'd have a partial positive side from the thing that's getting to spend less time with the electrons. So both of these, we could call them polar solvents. Polar solvents. And a general idea throughout chemistry is that polar solvents are better at dissolving ions. Because a polar solvent, when you have kind of positive negative charges, things are flipping around, they're partially attracted to the other positive ends of the other molecule. You can imagine that it's very easy for an ion, for something that is positively or negatively charged here, to kind of get mixed in to the fray. Now the difference between these two is obviously what the oxygen is attached to. Here the oxygen is attached to some carbons, here it is attached to hydrogens. And oxygen is far more electronegative than the hydrogens are. It's a much bigger differential than the case between oxygen and carbon. So in this situation, you will see scenarios where it is possible in a mixture. Remember, these things can be really, really messy. It's just there's a lot of just random bumping that's going on over here. That oxygen is so electronegative that it can oftentimes take this pair that's in this bond right over there. And if it did that, you would be left with the oxygen now having a negative charge. It now has a negative charge. Before this, let's see, I could draw all of its valence electrons. It was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So now it's going to have 1, 2, 3, 4. Actually, let me draw a little bit carefully. So you still have, you could kind of say half of this bond, so to the hydrogen. Now you have these two pairs, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and now it gains another pair. It got both of these electrons. It was already kind of sharing half of this bond, but now it has the whole bond. It has a negative charge, and then you have the hydrogen. Well, if you strip it of its electron, hydrogen is just a proton. It's just a proton floating around. So let me draw that. So this hydrogen is now just a proton, floating around. So when you have water is actually called a protic solvent. And then maybe another water molecule might pick this up and take it someplace, forming a hydronium cation. But this right over here, water is protic, which means that you might have these protons floating around, these hydrogen protons. While diethyl ether is not protic, even in a case that somehow one of the bonds gets, you don't just have little hydrogen protons floating around in this. And so what I want to now think about, now that we know about polar solvents, why they're polar, but we also know examples of protic and non-protic solvents, let's think about which might be better when we're talking about the types of reactions we're studying. So right over here, you might recognize, in fact, it's a good exercise. Pause this video and tell me these top three steps, what type of reaction is this, and these bottom two, what type of reaction is this. Well, in this top one, we see that this leaving group leaves first, and that this is the rate determining step. And then a nucleophile comes in here and attacks the carbocation and attaches. So this is a substitution reaction, but the rate determining step involves only one of the reactants. The leaving group's got to leave. So this right over here is an Sn1 reaction, only involving one of the reactants. The leaving group leaving is the rate determining step. This, on the other hand, both the nucleophile attacks and the leaving group leaves in one step. So this is a substitution involving a nucleophile, but both reactants are involved in the rate determining step. Now, since both SN1 and SN2 reactions need these ions floating around, you can imagine that they both benefit from polar solvents. So polar solvents are good for both. Polar solvents are good for both. Now let's think about whether it's good to have protic or non-protic environments for either one of these, for either one of these reactions. Well, to think about that a little bit more, let's think about the types of nucleophiles and the types of molecules we're dealing with. SN2 reactions, in order for this to happen, you have to have a reasonably strong nucleophile. So let's say reasonably strong nucleophile. In the SN1 reaction, well, you already have the carbocation set up here. The leaving group leaving was actually the hard part. So this could even work with a weak nucleophile. So even a weak nucleophile. The real thing you have to do is to get this leaving group to leave. And also, if we want to remind ourselves of some of the other kind of the stereochemistry of the reactions, in an SN1 reaction, it's actually nice to have a tertiary carbon. If these are also carbons, these little circles I drew here, that helps stabilize the carbocation. So if this was a tertiary carbon, this would favor SN1. We also know the tertiary carbon would not be good. If this is a tertiary carbon, that would not be good for SN2, because if these were carbon chains of some form, these three, this purple, this blue, and this orange thing, then it would have steric hindrance. The nucleophile would have trouble getting in. So this would be more likely to happen if you're dealing with a methyl carbon or a primary carbon, maybe a secondary carbon. So here, the nucleophile is reasonably strong. Here, it can even work with a weak nucleophile, polar solvent in either case. In the SN1, the key is stabilizing the leaving group, making it okay for the leaving group to leave. So what's going to help a leaving group to leave? Especially when a leaving group leaves, it typically has a negative charge. Well, if there were a bunch of protons flying around that could help stabilize this negative charge, that would help. In fact, this could then form a bond with one of those protons. It could donate electrons to one of those protons. And so a protic environment is good for the SN1, while on the SN2, since you have these strong nucleophiles, if you had protons flying around, instead of trying to attack the substrate right over here, the nucleophile would attack the protons. So you don't want that, then this thing won't happen. So you want non-protic for the SN2. So hopefully that gives a little bit of the basics of the solvents, and also allows us to compare these two reactions in interesting ways.